Welcome everybody to Compas on the Beat. I am Fernando Ramirez, Chargers beat reporter for Sports Illustrated, and with me as always my co-host Gilbert Manzano, Chargers beat reporter for the OC Register and LA Daily News. But Gilbert and I are not alone. We're starting this show with a special guest, Ryan Dyrud, founder and CEO of the LAFB Network, and now our business partner. So I gotta ask, what's up, bros?
That's a lot of energy, Fernando. We're recording this really early right now, but I'm just so happy Ryan is here to take some of this energy away from me. I'm gonna pass it on to you, Ryan, because I can't handle it. It's a Friday morning. I think it's 9 o'clock right now. I'm recording, so I'm trying to wake up. But I did love that introduction that Fernando gave you. I heard CEO, founder, and now a business partner. It sounds like you're gonna make us rich, Ryan. Are we gonna get rich with you working with you? What's going on here?
Well, hey, if I can do anything like what is happening with Dogecoin right now, maybe we will all be rich. Who knows? But fellas, thanks for having me on. Excited to chat with you. Great. It's been awesome getting to know you guys over the years. Gilbert, I see in the background your little XFL lanyard, which we all were in the booth during the short-lived six-week season, and we got to know each other more during that. So I'm super pumped to be working now with you guys, which I'm sure we'll get into more. But thanks for having me on Compas on the Beat. Excited to be one of the Compas today.
Dude, we're excited to have you, honorary compa for the day. It's funny because I remember when we're in the booth speaking about the booth. I mean, I was always next to Gilbert and I was always talking crap and everything. And like, I'm probably the loud one because of my energy. So I know Ryan would like look over and he'd be laughing at just like something stupid that I would tell Gilbert or just the fun that we would be having. Because I mean, the game was interesting and everything, but you kind of were there obviously working, but at the same time you're there having fun and hanging out with everybody. But the reason why we joined LAFB Network is because we're excited about the future of it. Ryan, you're doing some great things with it. Honestly, I mean, it's one of those things where Gilbert and I really sat back and you asked us, you're like, hey, can you guys like listen to this pitch? And we're like, yeah, we listened to it. And then Gilbert and I spoke after and we're like, you know what? This is a rising stock. I'm like, we need to, and Gilbert and I kind of discussed it, and he's like, we need to get in this. I'm like, all right, dude, let's do it. So together, obviously Gilbert and I partners and everything, we do everything and we're with it 100%. And we decided to join up with you, Ryan, and we're excited about it. And just wanting to know what are some of the big plans that you have for the LAFB network?
Well, yeah, I appreciate that, guys. And I mean, I'm super excited for you joining us because I know we'll take it to the next level. But before we even get into that, I want to back up real quick, too, to talking about the XFL because it's kind of funny looking back, just the differences of kind of where we were all at the time. And I'm not saying this at all as a downgrade to your guys' work ethic or credibility. So I don't want that to come out like that. But at the time, this was my first like journalistic job. Like I started LAFB Network literally 3 months prior to the XFL launching. So when we were just starting, I began talking with their PR, like, hey, this is the company I'm starting. We're doing LA football. Obviously the Wildcats are part of LA football. We want to be able to be at the forefront. And so they actually gave us, okay, yeah, you get credentials of this. So for me, I was like, so pumped. Like I got to be on the field. You guys have been covering the Chargers for years, been on the field. You've met Phillip Rivers. You've been in the locker room. So the XFL to you is like, it's just what I got to do during the spring. I'll hang out and have free food in the press box and talk football with my man, Gilbert or Fernando. So for me, I was like all into it. And you guys were like, yeah, this is cool, but we're just here having a good time. So I think it's funny seeing how the different perspectives were. But anyway, about LAFB. Sorry, I got way sidetracked there. So your question was what? Where we want to take this thing?
Can I interject, Ryan, from XFL story? You know, since you know, can I call you a rookie at the time? You were kind of a newbie, Ryan. And
yeah, amateur, whatever you want to say.
Fernando and I have seen a lot of football and some really bad football. So when we saw XFL for the first time, we were kind of just making a lot of jokes and laughing. And I was like, oh, and then so I think we're looking at you, Ryan, and seeing how professional we're like, okay, it's a new league. Let's cut these guys some slack in this league. They'll figure it out. So I was like, okay. You know, we got used to, we got spoiled with the NFL. So when the XFL came around, that first game at Dignity Health, whatever, StubHub Center, whatever you want to call it, in Carson.
Yeah.
At the dig, whatever. We're at SoFi Stadium. We're moving up, Ryan. Yeah. We're shooting up SoFi Stadium. Yeah. But that first game was really sloppy. And I wrote a story, and I was very honest because they had a lot of work to do. And I got some backlash, but, you know, I keep it 100. I keep it honest. But after that first game, I think we came back for the second home game, and it was pretty fun. Now it was fast-paced, moving. and you saw it going, you know, so RIP XFL 2.0, but it was just kind of funny seeing your reaction, like how serious you were. Me and Fernando and I kind of just laughing and everything, but we took it serious. We took your lead and we figured it out.
Which is funny because I'm like one of the least serious guys anyone knows. I think it was just because in that moment I was like, all right, I finally here. I got to like pretend like, not pretend, but like treat this like a real gig. But we're getting way off a rabbit hole. But what I always tell people about the XFL, because I had friends like, well, how do you know? It's just not like good football. Like all I care about is good football, blah, blah, blah. Like that was the quote always people would say. And I'm like, well, yes, but I compare it to this. If you're watching college football and you watch an SEC game, you know, Alabama, Clemson, obviously Clemson's the ACC, but if you watch that brand of football and then you go watch a WAC game or a Mountain West game, it's going to be a lesser brand, but it's still football. It's still fun. It's still good to watch. Like Colorado State Air Force, that's a fun game. It's a good rivalry in the state of Colorado. Colorado State Wyoming, like those are all fun games. It's just not Alabama Clemson. So that's what I always kind of compared to people, what the XFL was. And hopefully The Rock does bring it back. And we can actually see that in 2022. But
The Rock.
The Rock, baby. I know
he holds champion.
I know he holds up close to your heart, right, Fernando?
Oh yeah, because when he gets in front of the millions and millions of The Rock supporters, he gets hyped, he gets excited. So it's gonna be awesome to see The Rock and obviously Danny Garcia both try and redo this. But in my opinion, real quick, I think the NFL needs to get behind this. This is the only way it's gonna work. If the NFL gets behind the XFL or whatever they're gonna do, that is the only way. They need to treat it as like you know how the Chinese league in the NBA and or the basketball, some veterans go out there, they go play, and then they come back in time for the playoffs, and then they end up getting signed by a team and stuff. So I think if they did something to that extent, if the NFL did treat it as like a developmental league, like NXT and WWE, maybe it could work. But I mean, that's just my hot take. But hey, we're getting off track.
I was going to say, Fernando.
I know.
Are we plugging the XFL 3.0 or are we going to plug LAFB? What's going on here?
My bad, bro.
Last thing about it.
Oh, yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Okay, whatever.
Last thing about it. Did you see, though, just announced like a few days ago that there's talk that the XFL and the CFL will actually have like a championship game between the two.
I saw that. That's really
kind of cool.
I kind of like that.
You know what I think they're taking away is when Liga MX and the MLS, they have a tournament that is like the CONCACAF Champions League, kind of like the European style. I believe that that's what they're trying to do, and I think it'd be cool. The only thing is, what are the rules? Because you know Canadian different Football fields. League is a lot different, unless the Canadian Football League is going to come out and say we're going to be exactly like the NFL and we're going to have those kind of rules. But I mean, that would be very interesting. I'd love to see how that would work. But yeah, back to LAFB. I mean, Gilbert trying to get us off topic and I'm trying to reel us back in. So yeah, Ryan, just tell us a little bit about the direction that you guys are headed and kind of a little bit more about your big plans with LAFB.
Yeah, well, the direction we're headed, I like to say.
We're headed.
We're all together now. Yeah, I mean, those that don't know LAFB, we just, you know, we cover the LA football teams. That's our niche, the Rams, the Chargers, the Trojans, and the Bruins. And if the Wildcats do come back, we'll add that to our portfolio again. But, you know, I just felt that the coverage was a little underrepresented at the time when I started this. And so that's what we wanted our focus to be on. And then we're taking that, you know, to the next level, not just having, you know, written content. We're trying to adapt from what old newspapers, old media was. And so we'll have written content, obviously, in digital form. We'll have podcasts, which is where you guys come in. You know, we're going to have a podcast. Frosty and I have one that covers all teams. And then we're going to have a podcast for each team specifically. And then a few kind of generic LA-based podcasts, such as yourselves, such as Compas on the Beat, that kind of does a little bit of everything within the LA culture, which I think is so awesome. And then on top of that, we want it to be like a lifestyle company where we're in talks right now with a few players. I'm getting on a call today with a former Bruin about licensing some clothing and merchandising that they're going to license with us, working together, that we can get out and get in fans' hands. So it's kind of a tangible thing that they can like have and own. And it's a part of the team, a part of the teams they support, a part of LAFB. So we're all this kind of intertwined circle. Once things open back up, we're doing, you know, meetups and tailgates with our shows, hopefully doing live stuff, but also just us being involved, you know, draft stuff. With that just being 2 weeks away, we're in talks with some bars to do stuff there. So just really taking LA football, taking what it represents, what it's about, giving you great coverage of those teams, but also intertwining in the community and engaging, and not just being somewhere where you flip open to, you know, page 2 on the news, you read it and you move on. You actually indoctrinate it into your everyday life and into whatever you do, whether it be listening to podcasts, reading, wearing clothing, or being out, you know, in the community at the local taco shop, and, you know, we're there as well. So kind of a long-winded answer of kind of what we are trying to build and create. And I think it's something that is a little different that hopefully, you know, fans can get behind.
No, Ryan, I wish you kept going longer, because everything you kept saying was, to me, was big plans, good ideas. I'm gonna get rich. I'm gonna get a Bugatti in a couple of weeks. I'm gonna get a Ferrari, all that. So Ryan, you know, I'm glad we're teaming up and we're becoming a business partners. And I like, you know, saying we're in this together. Mm-hmm. And as one thing we learned in a weird 2021 is, you know, jumping in a stock before, you know, it goes to the moon. So you have big plans. You're gonna take us to the moon, LAFB Network. So I'm glad that Fernando and I kind of decided to take this jump and, you know, kind of give you some backstory. We were a little skeptical because we had like four episodes and like, is it too soon to kind of, you know, start teaming up with people? Should we keep doing our own thing? But Ryan, it just felt like you got the vision. You know what we're trying to do. So everything you were saying there, it was exactly what I wanted to hear. Like, you haven't changed your tune at all. So, you know, I was a little weary at first. Like, should I trust this guy, Ryan? You know, we have known each other for a couple of years, but I see the work ethic. I see you putting in work. So I love the big plans. But also, Ryan, you've gained the trust of a Mexican family, so you got my trust. And I got to ask you, Ryan, because, you know, you're married to a Latina. You have a cute daughter. What is it like being the white guy at Mexican parties? I need to know that. I got to ask you.
I mean, it's every stereotype out there that people know that you see on YouTube or whatever. It's true. Like, I get the most crap always. I mean, let me say this from the beginning, though. This family, my wife's family, you know, has been awesome. Like, took me in as their own, made me an honorary Mexican, if you will.
El gringo.
Yeah. But I get all the names. I get all the crap. I was, you know, always, as soon as I remember when Trump ran for office 4 years ago, my whole family was like, oh, we know who's voting for Trump in the family. And like, even though I didn't, but that was just the automatic, like, being the white guy in the family. So yeah, you know, it's a fun give and take, and, you know, sometimes I give it back when I'm feeling when there's been a couple cervezas that have been passed around. Sometimes I'll give it back. But no, I mean, it's been
cervezas. I like that. Right.
Yeah. But it's been fun. And, you know, they're just such a close knit family all living here. I mean, not all, I mean, you know, Mexican family, there's like 500 of them. So, they're all over the place, but her immediate family is close, knit and right here in LA. So we all, you know, all the holidays are together, and it's fun though, man. And they've taken my daughter and like one of their own, and we have that support. And, you know, it's like, you know, you just have unlimited babysitters, if you will, which is nice.
Oh yeah. And they call that liquid courage, by the way. Cerveza alcohol is liquid courage. So that's why Ryan is able to kind of go back and forth a little bit when he's had a couple,
because
it's liquid courage. 100%. Yeah. But honestly, Ryan, one of the main reasons why we really wanted to join this is because you told us, I don't want to change anything about Compas on the Beat, and that's what we're all about. Gilbert and I are all about storytelling, about getting people and have them tell their stories. I mean, obviously, we're NFL beat writers, but we're more about trying to expand. I mean, we've had great people on. We talked with Uncle Joe Reedy, shout out, a couple of days ago about WWE. We like to do different things, so that's really what drew us to working with you, because you said, I don't want to change anything about it. I just want you guys to do what you're doing and just be under the LAFB network. And that's really what drew us. And because, I mean, obviously Gilbert and I started this, and we started this to do storytelling and to do something different. And the fact that you were willing to continue with our vision, that really was truly awesome. And honestly, we're excited. I speak for myself and Gilbert. I think we're very excited about this, and we're very excited about LAFB Network, where you're taking it. We're honestly very, very hyped.
Good. Yeah. No, I'm glad to hear that. I think there's, with a good company, and I'm not even saying we are one yet, obviously striving to be, but I think there's, you know, a few factors. And one is, you know, surround yourself with people that are hard workers like yourself. So, you know, I consider myself a hard worker, and I know you guys are too. So that was one factor. Two, people you just enjoy being around. I mean, who wants to work with people they don't like? Yeah. I'm sure we all have worked with people we don't like, and we all have worked with people we do like, and it just makes it that much better. And three, which is kind of most important, and I can't claim this quote, someone else said it. It may have been Warren Buffett, but I've kind of taken this philosophy that, you know, create a culture where you build people up where they can leave and go on their own, but the culture makes them not want to. So like I told you from the beginning, hey, this is your thing. We're building it together, but this is your podcast, Compas on the Beat. Don't change anything. You're not contractually obligated to stay here for a certain number of time. So, hey, if we get 2 years from now and we're exploding, but you guys have an opportunity to just go on your own, you can do that. But my goal is we create a culture where we're like, yeah, we can do that, but we don't want to because we like being here. So that's kind of the whole thing. So yeah, just excited, guys. Pumped.
We definitely love it, Ryan, and we appreciate you coming on and talking to us. We're honestly very excited about the future of LAFB Network, and thank you again for bringing us on. And ladies and gentlemen, coming up next, we have a very special interview. We're talking to MJ Acosta-Ruiz, the host of NFL Total Access. Don't go anywhere because this is going to be awesome. Folks, here she is. I am excited about this next guest. We're talking to not Michael Jordan. No, we're talking to MJ Acosta-Ruiz, the host of NFL Total Access. MJ, how are you doing? Thank you for jumping on with us today.
I'm great. It's so good to be here with you guys. Like, just chilling with my friends. I wish you were like at a bar or something, but hey, we'll take a Zoom call.
That's the kind of energy we try and bring to Compas. It's just hanging out with your buddies, talking and everything. We're excited about you coming on.
Yeah.
Sidebar, Compas is like possibly the best name for this pod ever. I love it.
I love that response, MJ. And I think you're better than Michael Jordan. So I'm very excited to have you on the show. And you're already giving the name a shout out.
Yes. Listen, I'm here for Compas. But you know my favorite Spanish nickname in the NFL, Fernando, is Patricio mi compa, for that specific reason. It's just my homies, hanging with my homies.
Well, MJ, we love it. We like to see you, you know, on camera, also on NFL Total Access. You're a superstar, MJ. And I want to just, you know, make sure that people get what you're doing. Because I thought it was a very, you know, historic big deal. An Afro-Latina hosting a show on NFL Network for the first time. First of all, you got to take me back. When you first found out the good news about, you know, I watch this show all the time, so I love to see you on there. When you found out the good news, what was the emotion like? What did you do first? Kind of take me back to that story of how you kind of earned that job.
Well, the news came in the middle of the pandemic, right? So when I tell you I was not expecting this. It was a time when, you know, a lot of people were getting laid off or furloughed. The last thing I expected was that they were going to promote me and move me to another city in the middle of the apocalypse. So it's just a testament, I think, to one of those things that I'm sure your parents have said this a million times. Lo que está para ti, nadie te lo quita. Not even the pandemic can take away what is meant for you. And that's exactly sort of what led me here. You know, I spent two years with the NFL Network before moving to Los Angeles and San Francisco as a reporter covering the Niners and the Raiders predominantly, but mostly the entire league. I mean, at any point, you sort of have to be ready to cover any team they need you to. And I was also able to fill in on a lot of different shows on Total Access, on NFL Now, on Good Morning Football. So I was able to flex that hosting muscle that I've always had. And I really worked hard to show them everything that I could bring to the table and that I was willing to work whenever and however they needed me to. Sometimes that's a detriment, you know, to always be the one side. Yeah, I'll do it. You can burn yourself out a little bit, but at the end of the day, the proof is in the pudding and how much work you put in, and your work ethic will always precede you in this business.
Yeah, MJ, I don't want to say you were surprised, but it sounds like they had you in mind. They wanted you for this role, this job. So it wasn't really like an applying process. You were the first and the only choice, and they wanted you. Is that kind of what the feel I'm getting?
Do you know something? I don't know, because I don't know all that. But I do know that I had, you know, one of the things as I got a little older and evolved in this industry, I've been doing this for almost 12 years, was to really ask for what you want and what you feel you have earned. And I know how much work and how much preparation I've put into my career, into really honing my skills, my credibility throughout the league specifically. So in 2020, as crazy as it sounds, I always pick a word for every year. And my word for 2020 was bold. So be bold, ask for what you want, and have those conversations with your bosses. If you don't ask, you're never going to know, right? So at that point, you know, God had something even bigger in my mind than what I could have envisioned. I said, hey, I'd love the opportunity to do some more stuff in studio. I didn't have anything in mind in terms of a show. And meantime, you know, we're working in another direction and this opportunity presented itself and I was ready for it. So, it did take me off guard though. It really did. I was not expecting it. I remember looking at my husband and saying like, oh my God, this is really happening. He had the same reaction as you guys were like, yeah, duh, and be like, what else? But I think sometimes we're our harshest critics, and it's tough to even see ourselves the way that others do.
MJ, I know we'll get into a little bit of how I know about your career and everything in a little bit, but can you just talk about where your journey started? I mean, you went to Barry University. You started doing a lot of things within media. When did you know sports was the direction where you wanted to take your career?
Yeah, pretty early on. Once I started actually working as a journalist, sports was the first job that I got. Because I had always sort of lived in that space throughout my life and just as a sports fan, right? So when it came to sort of working and doing and aligning with what you love, I knew that covering sports was going to be the best fit for me. I knew it was going to be a lot of work, though, and I started in a very big market already. So I started in Miami, where most of the sports reporters and writers there had been there for a minute. So it's not like there's a ton of sort of opportunities there. So I took the ones that came at me and really held on and milked them for everything that I could. So I knew that sort of the news side of things, while I did that for a number of years, was just not the avenue that I wanted to go down. You got to be about that news life to really fully be successful and to do it justice, because it does take a certain amount of sort of gumption to go down that road. And so while I was a news reporter, I fully committed myself to that, but it sort of like tore at my soul a little bit every day. And when I did get opportunities to do sports, I could just feel the difference. Eventually I said, all right, I got to make a pivot. I got to leave Miami to really be able to spread my wings. And that's how, you know, opportunity came up in San Diego, where I met Fernando and sort of started a different course.
No, and I mean, we've been in newsrooms, MJ. We see everybody else is kind of, and we're like excited, hyped up, and we're walking around. Exactly. MJ, if people follow you on social media, they know, they see the cheerleading, bang, bang, bang. I mean, we all know the dancing and everything. Can you talk a little bit about that and kind of your journey as how you made it into cheerleading and went from that and increased your platform and kept on really progressing through this field?
Yeah. So a lot of people ask me about that, because I think the assumption is that I was a cheerleader first, and then that led me to journalism. And I was actually a reporter before I became an NFL cheerleader. So I've been a dancer my entire life. That is like my one true love, my heart's passion. But, you know, the way that your 30s are set up, you can only dance, but for so long, Lord fix it. So I actually started off in the biz a little later than most people, because I took some time to follow my passion of dance. That's the only thing that I knew for certain that I wanted to do in my life. I was in college and I was very lost. So I didn't like leave high school from doing like the morning announcements and like, no, like I'm going to be a journalist. I had no freaking clue. All I knew is I wanted to dance. So I did that collegiately for 3 years, and I was no closer to what I wanted to be when I grew up than I was when I started, you know? So I said, let me stop accumulating student debt for like a few years and figure out what the hell I want to do with my life. Ultimately, dance is what led me to television. I was cast on a television show for Mundos. It no longer exists, but it was like a sister network to Telemundo. So I was on this music show, and I fell in love with the production side of it, just the putting together of the show, a rundown meeting, talking with the host. I was like, this is cool as hell. It's a lot of work, but I really love this. And so the following semester, I enrolled back in school to the broadcast program. But at that point, I was 24 and I still had like a full 3 years left of school. So I was a little older by, you know, television standards, television broadcast standards than most of the people who are starting out in the biz. So I knew I had to like make up for lost time. There's no time to waste. I had to get in there. And so that's sort of how I started to build on it. After I graduated and got my first reporter job in English and in Spanish from a bilingual station, there was one more thing I wanted to check off dance-wise, and that was to become a Dolphins cheerleader. Fernando, you know this. Gilbert, you might not. I tried out four other times for the Dolphins, came all the way close to the finals, and didn't make the team. Four times in a row. So I still had a little something in me that said maybe I could make it. And so, of course, the year that I'm like working a full-time professional was the year that I made the team. But I did both. I did both at the same time. I was covering mainly high school sports, so it wasn't a conflict in that sense. Man, I had the best seat in the house to every Dolphins game. So I got to hear things and see things that most people, journalists included, never really get that point of view. And it was really nice to be part of an organization too, and to sort of see the other side of it and how the teams run too. So that experience to me was invaluable, I do have to say.
I got to say, I love your background, your story. And I'm learning something new all the time. And Fernando gave me a whole list of things you've done. So you do it all. You're very versatile.
And I just a lot of things.
And I love your path and your route. But I'm asking two questions, one kind of off the radar, because you are a dancer and you hosted a music show. Have you gotten the Bad Bunny tickets yet? I got to ask
Let me tell you something about these Bad Bunny tickets, okay? First of all, I spent way too much time, probably like over an hour, looking at the Bad Bunny ticket meme last night, like looking for Padrino for my Bad Bunny concert.
Yes.
Or there was another one that said, husband, who sold my PS5? Me at the Bad Bunny concert. Like, why are they so expensive, Benito? What's happening? This is wild. It's a pandemic. I'm like, mala. I can't be spending, you know, $500 for like nosebleed seats to Bad Bunny. I guess I'm going to watch him on the internet because.
You would think he would have made a lot of money off of WWE being with WrestleMania and everything.
Apparently not. But we also, like, this is also not, like, directly Bad Bunny, right? Like, we're going hard on him. Like, this is his people. They're trying to milk this shit. And you know what's going to happen? People are going to pay the money.
Oh, yeah.
They're going to pay the money. They're going to figure it out. They're going to take their stimulus check, whatever it is. I'm not mad at anybody. We need this. We need a concert in our lives. Yeah. So do you. No judgment. But that's a bit much.
MJ, I was ready to drop $500 before I got onto this.
I knew it.
I'm not gonna do it. I'm gonna just maybe I will come December or January. But
live your life.
You know, we gotta do what we gotta do for our gente. But MJ, I gotta ask you about one more background question for at least for me. You have a full extensive background, but something stood out to me. You used to call boxing and MMA fights in Florida.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How was that like? Was this like professional, amateur? What type of combat sports were you covering?
Yeah, there were sort of like, I suppose we could call it like amateur level, but I mean, it was regulated by the Florida Boxing Commission. So it was a lot of MMA. I remember I did one specific event and it was a combo event. It was boxing and MMA together. So they had a boxing ring and then like an octagon. It was freaking wild. And so I was interviewing all of these fighters on the boxing side and the MMA side for weeks leading up to it. So I was going to all these jiu-jitsu studios and all these boxing gyms. It was intense. But the beautiful part of it was that a lot of boxers were coming in from the Caribbean and from South America, most of whom did not speak English. So I was able to really interview these guys and get to know these guys who otherwise weren't getting any coverage because the English language media couldn't really speak to them without a translator. So it was really cool to see some of them. I will say, like, post-match and interviews are not glamorous, all right? These guys are huge, and they're sweaty, and, like, you know, like, this, it's not conducive to, like, a COVID world interview, right? There's, like, spit and stuff all over the place. It was intense. Blood. I got a real different perspective of the boxing world. It is so much more gruesome in real life than what you see on television, but man, it was cool. Like, it was really cool to actually be in the ring. Especially as a woman, it wasn't really seen. Like, most people probably thought I was like the ring card girl, which, by the way, they're fierce. so it was a really cool experience.
That's awesome, AJ. And MJ, I really like that you embrace a bilingual, because that type of skills does matter in the field. And mm-hmm. you're interviewing, you know, boxers, baseball players, NFL players, you know, that skill really comes in handy. But MJ, before I let you talk about San Diego and Fernando, because I want to get to know Fernando from 5 years ago. I want to ask you questions about that. Before I get there, I got to ask you, your parents are from Dominican Republic. Mm-hmm. Where is that the best food for Dominican Republic in Los Angeles? Because I need to try some of that food.
You know, I haven't really, because of the pandemic, I haven't really been able to explore too much. But there is a place here called Mofongos LA. That has like Puerto Rican and like Dominican food. It's like in North Hollywood. I have not been there yet, so I can't vouch for it, but it's on my list of places to go. But if you're familiar with LA, you know, I'm more on the west side, like going to North Hollywood, that's like a day trip. Like, I got to plan it out and make sure, you know, we have like bathroom stops along the way before we get there. But it's on my list. Once I get those for you, I got you though. Full list.
I'm ready.
And honestly, those lists, MJ is serious. Like, she does have lists. Like, mm-hmm. don't think yeah. she's playing. It's not a mental list. No, no, no. It is written down. She knows what she what list she has. But
I'm a lister.
Shifting a little bit to San Diego, MJ. I remember the first time I met you. Gilbert, this is the crazy part. The Chargers had a media day. Actually, you know what? It's probably around right now. Like,
it happened, would be around right now.
Around right now. That's incredible. So mm-hmm. we had a media day pro day. So they
were the media combine.
Yeah. So it was around this time that MJ and I met. And so our good friend Dante Lascano. Everybody's heard about Dante and everything. Everybody knows about Dante. Dante and I had injuries. We had injuries. Dante and I had injuries, so we couldn't participate. It was one of those things.
Allegedly.
So we see somebody just killing every single obstacle course, and I'm like, wow, that's incredible. And like we're watching. And the winner is MJ wins like the competition. She kills it. Bill Johnston, shout out to Bill Johnston, who used to be the PR director. He literally he gives MJ, I think, what was it, like dinner somewhere?
It was a Nike gift card.
Oh, Nike gift card. There you go. Yeah. So then we go back to the media center, and Dante and I are talking. And he's like, "Well, I want to meet whoever she is." And I'm like, "Okay, well, let's go over." So we start talking. An hour, 2 hours passed by, and we're just sitting there talking with MJ, and it was just so awesome to get to know her and everything, because we didn't really see a lot of people out here who did sports, who was a woman, and then on top of that, she was Latina, so it was different to kind of see that different aspect, and we just got to talking, and it was incredible. And honestly, right now, I'm gonna get a little sentimental. I don't mean to, but honestly, if it wasn't for MJ, she gave me my break. She got me in. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be right here. I wouldn't be doing this Compas on the beat. Like, I don't know where I'd be, but she literally opened the door for me, and I will be ever thankful to her. She's a mentor. She's a big sister to me. She's everything. So MJ, honestly, from the bottom of my heart, I just want to say thank you so much for the opportunity that you gave me all those years ago.
Aw, Fernando.
I know,
but I just... you know I'm a crier too. How dare you?
I know, but we're gonna.
Listen, Fernando's one of those people. I appreciate you saying that. Thank you, because a big part of my sort of what I want to leave behind many years from now, once I'm done with this, is that I opened doors, even if it was just a little bit for other folks. But I will say this: Fernando's one of those people. He was gonna get himself in one way or another, because and you know this, Gilbert, he has that gumption, he has that like X factor sort of determination, and that is why for me I was like, all right, this is somebody I can really pour into, because he already has sort of those basic things, those instincts that you need as a sports reporter to really make it in this world. And on top of that, he was unbelievably kind, very, very helpful to me. I was the new girl in town. He didn't have to talk to me or help me at all. A lot of people didn't, but a lot of people did too. There was a really good group there, especially those of us covering the Chargers. Nick Hardwick, great dude. Yeah. I mean, he was really, really nice. A lot of guys too. So I always want to be able to reciprocate that to other people, but you worked for it and you did it on your own too. So don't discount your effort.
No, I know. I appreciate it.
I guess I got to thank you, MJ, then, because if you never gave Fernando a shot, we wouldn't be doing Compas on the Beat. So I, too, shed a tear.
You're welcome.
But I got to ask you, MJ, because Fernando's very energetic, and we like to make a joke here that, you know, I'm not on the same level. If we're doing something in the morning, I'm a little sluggish, I'm a little tired. But as soon as I see Fernando, you can do it, Fernando. Do what you say. And just kind of...
Anytime Gilbert shows up at Chargers or even our opening for the podcast, the way I greet him, I go, "What's up, bro?" And I get him all, but like, he could come in and all sluggish and this and that, and I greet him with that, and I could tell his demeanor just flips.
How do you not laugh?
That's the thing. I always laugh, but it's just like, you know, I worked hard the day before. I'm a little tired. It could be 8 a.m. and he hits me, "What's up, bro?" But then it's like, hey, it's time to work. It's showtime. So
yeah, it sets the tone.
Exactly.
So but he could be talking to anybody else. He could be greeting people while he walks in. I don't care. Still going to greet him from far away.
So how was Fernando 5-6 years ago? Was he ever shy at all or no? Am I wrong there for sure?
Shy.
Yeah.
Absolutely not. Are you kidding? No. But that's the whole point. You sort of need need that part of it, which is interesting because sometimes you can watch Fernando as he's working, right? And he's zeroed in. So he's paying attention. He's taking his notes. So you might think that he's like more of an introvert, like just, but no, like this dude is a people person. Like it doesn't matter who's in front of him. He can talk to anybody, whether it's a WWE wrestler, a defensive end, a GM, a team owner, or whoever, like, you know, who's the concession stand. Like, it doesn't matter the spectrum. Like, he's going to talk to every single person, and that's a tremendous quality to have. But he always brings, like I said at the beginning, he brings that energy, which is also a very special thing, right? You need it. Like, Fernando knows I was going through a lot of, like, sort of dark times in San Diego, so it was selfishly so nice to have him there with me at work to sort of lift me up and lift my spirits too, and like almost like, hey, you got to be in tune with your star player, we going in, let's go, type of energy. So it was great.
It was hilarious because I mean Telemundo had just started when I arrived at NBC, so mm-hmm. This is literally it. Gilbert, MJ would go in at 6:30 to go do her show with Telemundo, and then she'd come to, mm-hmm. She'd do Telemundo Sports. She'd come right out, come over. We'd go over what she was going to do for the 6:50 hit of sports. She'd go and do that. Then at night, this is the crazy part.
The
11 was crazy. At 11:15, mm-hmm. She had to be at Telemundo. And at 11:19, she was done at Telemundo. At 11:20, she had to be in NBC starting off doing sports. So all you hear is, and you can hear her high heels just coming down the line, and you turn around and there she is running into there. And sometimes people would get, the directors, everybody would get so nervous, but as soon as that red light went on, you knew MJ was going to be there. But there were times where it was right at the, like, at the split second, but she'd be there and she'd be ready. It was honestly, like, I think MJ got her best workout doing that.
I never had to go to the gym working in that time space. But the crazy part is like the technical side. So why the producers sort of get a little nervous is this is two completely different stations, right? So from the back end, it's two different control rooms, two different sets of teams sort of running each newscast. So I had two sets of mics, two sets of earpieces, and like they're all hooked like sort of like the back of my dress or like whatever I was wearing that day. So I had to like sort of look back, like I hope I'm turning on the right one, and that I'm punched into the right show, and that I'm speaking in the correct language for like the audience that I'm about to talk. It was a lot. I mean, it either really helped my brain function or I don't know. I'm starting to think it's the latter recently because my memory is not serving me as well as it used to. But it really was such a unique situation to do that every day, Monday through Friday, right? It was not just like, oh, okay, today they need me to like do both. This was, I had two full-time jobs there. And I think there are very few, if any, other sports journalists who can say the same. So it's a point of pride to me. And like Fernando was producing for me for both on many occasions. Sometimes I was producing alone for one and he'd have to sort of handle the other or we'd switch. But it was a tag team effort. We had a few other producers as well, but he was the only other bilingual person other than myself in the sports department. So yeah, we leaned on each other quite a bit.
It's kind of like when for the writers, like we have a deadline, it's like 9:50 and the story's not in. And editors are freaking out. Where's the story? I'm like, you gave me 9:50. It's going to be there on time. So
right,
you can relax on that. But MJ, it's awesome to hear your story. And sometimes the longer path pays off because you develop more skills, you network.
Oh, yeah.
And you do all that on the path and you meet new people like you guys did together. But have you, I know it's been a while and it's been about 8 months now since you started hosting NFL Total Access, have you had a chance to kind of just sit back and soak it in? Cause you know, it's all about working hard. I was going to say, have you had any time or do you kind of, you're about moving forward, but I know you understand the magnitude of how big it is, but no time yet to kind of be like, wow, this is pretty cool.
I mean, I try to be very present, right? But the thing is, everything moves so fast on a daily basis. And so the show I'm doing now was previously hosted by two people. So now I'm doing, you know, the job of that's always been done by two individuals. But because we're in a pandemic, we have half the resources, right? So it's not as many people in the studio. The producers we do have are either working from home or I don't see them at all. So it's a heavier lift sort of on me. And then on top of that, it's not like my analysts are in studio. They're all away as well. So I very much felt like I was on this little island at the beginning. And like, this was my first time hosting a national daily show. So I was like, oh shit, this is happening. It's real. But there's also no time to think about it. So I had to sort of find those moments that said, okay, ask for what you need. Let them know, like, hey, this is a lot. But that goes back to what I was saying at the beginning. Like, the people who are always like, yeah, I'll do it. No problem. Like, if that's you and you're listening right now, you'll ask for help. It's okay. Like, they're not going to think any less of you. It's very, very necessary to make sure that you have the resources you need within reason, right? Like, right now, everybody's spinning a million plates. We all have more stuff on our plates. And I have to give a shout out to you know, our stage crew, our production staff, over at NFL Total Access, because it really has been a challenging year and there's no playbook for it, right? Like, there was nothing to tell us, like, oh, this is what you do in the middle of a pandemic if you want to do a live show in studio. No, no one's ever done it before. So the fact that we stayed on live the entire season and are still doing so now into the off season is nothing short of a miracle, but also a testament to the great team that we have and everybody there. So it's been nuts, but there really is no time to be like, oh, look at us. We did that. But I guess I should, Robert. I should really take in the time to kind of soak it all in.
MJ, what do you feel like when you moved from NBC San Diego to NFL Network, mm-hmm. when you got to cover the Seahawks, you got to cover the Raiders, and you got to cover the 49ers, yeah. What was your biggest memory or your biggest takeaway from your two seasons covering either of those teams or anything like that?
Yeah. Oh, man. There's so many. There's
I got
so many.
Mine, I got mine for you. So.
Okay, you go first.
All right. You on a yacht with DJ Khaled.
Okay, but that wasn't even like team related. That was
okay,
like
I don't care. Super Bowl related. I thought that was the most awesome thing ever.
Yeah, I mean, that was pretty sick. And the thing was, like, I partially grew up, spent most of my life in Miami. So, like, I would listen to DJ Khaled on the local radio when I was in high school. And when it wasn't even, like, the main radio station, I'm talking, like, he was doing, like, the overnight show. So he's definitely, like, a South Florida guy. And as much as that experience for me was full circle, like, I started, you know, I grew up here, started my career here, and now I'm back hosting and showing everybody around at the Super Bowl in my town. So to do it with a guy who I'd been listening to since high school, it was crazy. Like, him and Dave Bruttman basically run that town. Like, do not be fooled. And so it was really cool to sort of be like, oh, okay, I'm sitting here with both of them on the Groot, which is Dave Bruttman's, one of his goals, I assume.
Yeah.
I don't know. But it was really, really cool. And he could not have been nice. Like, he's the chillest, you know, all that, another one, like, that's one side of, but he's like really, really chill.
We're the best.
And MJ told me, like, when I went to that Super Bowl, she told me Miami's crazy, this, that. I didn't know how crazy it was. I was walking with Eric Williams. I mean, everybody loves Eric. We're a friend mm-hmm. of the show. We're walking. And we see Floyd Mayweather on a bike with people. And like, we're like, oh, what's up, champ? And then he goes, he's just saying hi to people. I'm like, wow. I'm like, and everybody, and somebody goes, some guy's just walking, he's like, that's so Miami. And I just, yeah, I'm like, wow. I'm like, that is that's Miami. On brand.
Yeah. Yeah. I know people talk a lot about, like, here in LA, how there's a lot of, like, celebrity sightings, but, like, over there really is, if you go out any given night, like, you're going to run into somebody that's where the celebrities go to vacation and to party. So it's a really weird sort of place, but I love it.
MJ, now that I remember, you also interviewed Shakira and J-Lo, so that must have been big as well.
Oh, yeah, we're going to go ahead and say that.
Okay, there you go.
Look at her face.
I mean, I cried right before the interview, because I was like kind of overwhelmed, but two, it was like, so that was a moment, Gilbert, where I was like, okay, take this in, like, in this moment. And I was like, Shakira and J-Lo about to walk in here, and it's just me. It was crazy.
Just take it real quick. What was that like when they walk into the room and everything, and you're kind of like as soon as the camera went red, did you just MJ mode and just get it going, or did you get a little nervous before that?
Well, I was definitely there's not a lot of people who I'm starstruck by. Denzel Washington was one of them when I interviewed him. J-Lo and Shakira, definitely up there as well. Beyonce and Oprah would probably be the only other two people. But when I tell you, J-Lo has an actual literal glow around her, like, I wish I was making this up. It is crazy. It is nuts. So she walked in first, and it was like, but you know me, for now, I always try to, like, sort of like break the ice a little bit. I hate that, like, super quiet like 30 seconds before and then like, hey, that's so fake to me. Like, I always want to try and talk to you a little bit. So yeah. I did. And we had a couple of moments like right before where we all sort of chit chatted and it was really cool. I was like, yo, I'm for real, like just having a conversation with J-Lo and Shakira right now. I will never forget that. If I do nothing else the rest of my career, like, I think I'm good.
Oh no, there's a lot left in that career. There's going to be a lot bigger moments. MJ, just real quick, Gilbert and I have been talking draft, it seems like, for the last few weeks. On a scale of 1 to 10, how crazy do you think this draft is going to be? I feel like it's going to be one of the craziest ones we've ever seen.
I think so, too. I was just having this conversation, like, everybody, you know, the Niners, and they did that crazy trade to get that third overall pick, and everyone's like, oh, it's obviously a quarterback, right? Like, you don't trade all of that bounty to not get a QB. I'm like, listen, I spent a lot of time around Shanny and John Lynch, and I feel like there's something cooking, man. Like, they could very well just go like Justin Fields and like grab a quarterback and like groom him under Jimmy G. Who knows? But I would expect the unexpected in this draft more than any other, just because we're going into another unprecedented season and the type of talent that there is around the league. Like, the league is changing. There is a very palpable shift in the type of athlete that is needed in the league and what teams need to really make it to the Super Bowl. So I wouldn't be surprised if they take like the best athlete out there, you know, Kyle Pitts at number 3. Does that make a whole lot of sense? Yeah, probably not, but it's not off the board. Nothing is off the board, I think, this year more so than ever.
Go ahead, Gilbert.
No, I was going to say, I want to see a curveball too at number 3. Everybody's assuming it's a quarterback or Mac Jones, but Kyle Pitts, George Kittle, that'd be fun.
You know who could be the real big curveball is Atlanta at number 4, because presumably they have Matt Ryan there. He's good. He's far from being done. Like, he's still solid out there. I just think they got some bad juju on him in Atlanta, because it wasn't like they weren't putting up points, right? That they were putting up big numbers, 30-something points a game for a good part of the season. But then they had us at the end of each game, and then they would lose it, right? Like, what's happening?
Kind of like the Chargers.
That's MJ's favorite. That's MJ's favorite word. She learned that when she was in San Diego, and she loved it.
Yeah, that's not a universal Spanish word.
It is. No, it is. Okay. But we would use it, like, in the Caribbean, we use it in a different context, but, like...
Gotcha.
You could use it. It's a verb. It's an adjective.
Everything.
Honestly, MJ, thank you so much for joining Compas on the Beat. I just want to let you know you're an honorary compa. We love to have you on. It was exciting. Anything else you want to tell the listeners before we head out?
Listen, I love that, you know, there's so much... more representation now for us in the Latino community. Like, this is freaking awesome just to be able to talk to you guys, to go back and forth in English and in Spanish. Like, there's a lot of us out there who really love this game, who represent for our countries and for the United States just as hard. So thank you guys for having this platform. Like, this is so much fun. We're going to see a lot more of it. And I'm excited to bring more of it to the NFL platform.
Yo, it's your compa Gilberto. Now, I wanted to pause the pod for a second before we shift over to the next guest, which I'm very excited to introduce, Adam Hill, Heidi Fang, my former colleagues at the Las Vegas Review-Journal. Just wanted to take a quick pause and remind everyone to read our work at the websites. As many of you know, we're also Chargers beat reporters, Fernando and myself. So please go to the Orange County Register website, read all my work there. And also you can go to the LA Daily News website to read all my Chargers draft coverage there. Then when you're done reading all my content, shift over to Sports Illustrated and read Fernando Ramirez's stories there. He has plenty of Chargers draft coverage as well. And like you know, I always like to say the more Chargers stories, the better. So check out the podcast, check out the stories. We do it all. We really appreciate the support. Now back to Compas on the Beat.
So I'm very excited about these next guests. I'm introducing Heidi Fang and Adam Hill, MMA experts and Raiders reporters for the Las Vegas Review-Journal. A little blast in the past for my friend Gilbert here. How are you guys doing today?
I'm really great, man. Thank you so much for having us. Can't speak for Adam, though. Adam, how are you doing, man?
Oh, I'm good. I can't match your energy. Heidi always always upbeat in the morning. I'm not a morning person, but for you guys, no problem. Get up and do this.
Hey, Adam,
it's a giant cup of coffee secret.
Hey, I just had some coffee right now. I needed to wake up too, but I'm kind of like Adam. Fernando is very energetic, so
I'm about that energy.
I'll try to match it.
All right, let me try something else then, Adam, because I feel like we are former colleagues. I know you guys very well, so I wanted to do like a special intro. I wrote down a couple nice things. I know you like nice things, Adam. Is that okay to kind of share?
I don't like nice things, as you know. So you're already striking out. Let's go.
Okay. So that's why I'm gonna let Fernando say nice things about you. You know, a stranger is even better, right? Nice things from a stranger.
Oh yeah, that's comfortable.
Okay, so I'll start with Heidi, and I'll say I wrote down a lot of nice things for her, so hopefully she's okay with this. But for Heidi, I'm ready. Heidi, I have a ton of respect for you for your work ethic. I'll never forget the Raiders 2018 season when you covered the entire season. I think you were pregnant with Tristan.
Yeah.
And you went to road games. You even covered MMA events. Yeah. I think you were shooting pictures, editing videos. You were on camera, writing stories. And I never heard you complain. And I complain all the time to Fernando. All the time. But I remember Mexico City.
Oh, yeah.
you still didn't complain. It was like the highest altitude. I think you might have been 7 months pregnant with Tristan. Yeah. You were on the field taking pictures. Again, I really admire your work ethic. I don't know how you did it. So I got to ask you, what is your secret to just working hard?
No, all honesty, and it's going to get deep right now because a lot of people don't know all of this about me. My grandmother went through a really tough life and a really hard struggle, and so did my parents. And they all came from like really blue collar grassroots. You know, my father worked in fields. My grandmother was interned in Manzanar during World War II, and she was pregnant and had a baby in there. So when I was pregnant and I was thinking my feet hurt, I was like, well, at least I'm not sleeping on a bale of hay with a hay pillow with wood slats that are in the middle of Death Valley in June. You know, and those are things that she went through, her struggles, or, you know, at least. And my family is going to have more than 900 square feet of space to live in. So when I started out on my whole journey, like all of those things were motivating factors for me to be able to provide and have nice things. And, you know, unfortunately, my family, you know, they weren't highly educated. So for me, it was a big thing to get to college and to go and take that path on and, you know, to try to improve things for my life. And that's why I work so hard and why you don't hear me complain.
Wait, hold on. Can we start over? I can't follow that. I need to go first.
What that was doing? A great story. I was surprised I heard that. I was like, that was a great response, Heidi. Thank you. That was awesome.
Just, you know, it's just the roots where you come from, you know, and then trying to look up for bigger things and trying to really carve a path for yourself. And those are things my family didn't have the opportunity to do. And it makes me proud to be able to stand on my own two feet and try to, you know, forge a path for us.
That is honestly awesome. And that's what we're trying to build here with Compas. We talk about our stories. We talk about how we got started in our careers and everything. So now I'm going to turn my attention to Adam.
Please don't.
All right, Adam. I know you've never been pregnant or anything, but I've heard very good things that you work just as hard as Heidi. You've covered over 100 beats for the Las Vegas Review Journal, and I hear you filed a story from every Starbucks in Las Vegas, which is a huge accomplishment. I've only been twice, but I know that there's a lot of Starbucks out there, so that's pretty cool. And then I heard that you're president of the Tyrod Taylor fan club. Adam, I got to know, what's your fascination with Tyrod and obviously a little bit more about all the Starbucks and the filing of stories?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not even going to try to compete with Heidi on this. So I'll just say, like, yes, I like to be out and about. Like, I can't work from home, although I guess I had to learn to over the last year, which was kind of something that we all had to do. But I've never been able to. Like, I just want to play with the dogs or, like, throw on TV or, like, you know, something. I can't work from home. So I just developed this habit of, you know, being out and about and, like, being out in the field and working at their Starbucks. I know all the ones that are 24 hours. I know where there's going to be seats at what time. Like, I should write a book about the Starbucks of Las Vegas and where to write at. That should be my next project. But as Gilbert and you just alluded to, and Gilbert must have told you, like, I can't stop covering things. So if there's something to be written about, I want to write about it. And that's my thing. As far as Tyrod, I grew up maybe the most obsessed Buffalo Bills fan that you're ever going to meet in your life. I could not get enough of that team. I loved everything about them. A lot of my family is from Orchard Park, right where the Bills are. You used to walk to the games from all my family's house and everything. So that was always cool. And for whatever reason, when Tyrod Taylor got there, like, he's like the greatest dude ever. Just such a good guy, quiet, humble. Took the Bills to the playoffs for the first time ever, you know, in my life, life since I was a kid watching Super Bowls. And it was a very cool experience. And you know, I've talked about this a couple of times. I don't really like to because it's very uncomfortable. But I went to a bunch of games his time there and just heard the abuse that he took from the crowd, the racial epithets that were flying his way. And it sucked. And it turned me off. Like, I had to stop being a fan anyway because I started covering the NFL. But it kind of also coincided with the abuse that he took and what he went through. Like, I took them to their first playoff appearance in 20 years. Like, what are you doing anyway? But come on. Like, he did not deserve that. And it just sucked to have to go through that. And it sucked to see that people are like that. You know, it just, you know, you already know. But in this time, in this day, in the freaking 2020, we're really going to act like that? Like, it was disgusting. So I went through that, and so I cheer for him wherever he goes. And it sucked. I mean, he got a concussion in Cleveland, lost his starting job to Baker Mayfield, and then he gets stabbed in the rib, in the lung, in with the Chargers. So it's been quite a path for him. So,
yeah, no,
I still have a support of his career
100%. And it's interesting because Gilbert and I really, I mean, his last year, we didn't really talk to him all that much because he was the backup quarterback, but he would talk to you and you could go up to him. Hey, Tyrod, how you doing? And then he'd start talking to you and you'd strike up conversation. Then this year he's the starter and we really got to know a little bit more about him. And he was very interesting human being, honestly. And the more you talk to him, the more you feel like he's that veteran. He might not be the starting quarterback, but he was still that veteran leader. Anthony Lynn, Tom Telesco, Justin Herbert, everybody raved about how professional he was, even after Justin took the starting job. So honestly, I tip my hat off to him, and I'm sure Gilbert does as well.
You know, I'll share a story from Adam in the support with Tyrod Taylor. When Tyrod Taylor signed with the Chargers, I think it was 2019, he was the backup to Phillip Rivers. But that was a very bad year for Phillip Rivers. So anytime Rivers threw an interception, I would get a text from Adam saying, where is number five? Put in number five already. And he knows I'm working, but I'm going to check my phone eventually. And he likes to make me laugh with that. And I tell him, hey, I see him right there. He's warming up, but he's not coming in yet, coach.
Well, the bad part is that I was also working, but I would know every time Phillip Rivers threw an interception, wouldn't I? I was on it. So yeah, I mean, it's just something that's going to you know, and now he's with the Texans, and we'll see what happens with Deshaun Watson there. The crazy, crazy stories going on there, too. So maybe he gets another chance. I would like to see him get another chance. It's just been kind of a brutal road for him since leading the Bills to the playoffs.
It's been a lot of stories with Tyrod Taylor. But Heidi, it's not just football, which I know you're like Adam. You cover everything as well. So I wanted to kind of get you guys back to some UFC. I called you guys experts. You guys are my go-to source for UFC, MMA, all that, you know, Bellator, whatever they have now. I learned that from you too. There's other things besides UFC. So I always say MMA, so forgive me on saying UFC. But Heidi, I'll start with you on for UFC 261 talk. There's a big match there with especially with the main event, Usman against Jorge Masvidal. And I gotta admit, Heidi, I'm a little surprised that they rescheduled this main event because Masvidal did not look good. I know he was on short notice for the first fight, for the first fight island, which I'm a little disappointed. It's not really a fight island. It was like inside, so whatever. But I was really hyped about that fight. But to reschedule it he got dominated. I'm going to say Masvidal did not look good at all. I know it was, again, on short notice, but Usman's on a different level. He is a nightmare, as they call him. So for you, Heidi, I ask you, are you a little surprised they rescheduled this rematch? And also, do you think Masvidal, with a full training camp, has a legit shot to beat him?
I think it's going to be a rinse, wash, repeat kind of fight for Usman. I don't think that the longer training camp is going to help Masvidal in any sort of way. And that's just because he's a natural striker. He's good at grappling. He's decent at wrestling. But he is not on the same level as Usman. When you look at the caliber athlete that he is when it comes to the wrestling game, he has found ways to just make nights miserable for his opponents that he faces. And I think that he's going to be really dominant in the division for quite some time. So, yeah, I don't think this is going to be any different for Masvidal than it was the first outing. No.
So you're not surprised if they reschedule it? Maybe it's just kind of a major draw fight. Why do you think they reschedule it so soon, especially how dominant he was for Usman?
I think maybe they're having a problem finding opponents for Usman. A lot of people probably don't want to face him, and Masvidal's always game, and it's a decent paycheck. You go up, you know, find him for a belt. You're not going to be slouching when it comes to the payout on the fight purse. So it's one of those things that, you know, for Masvidal, I'm pretty sure he wants to get that one back. And I think he thinks, yeah, with the full training camp, maybe I have a different plan for it. Maybe he saw a particular tendency that he thinks he can get to with Usman, like he did in the Askren fight. He saw the tendency, they planned for it. They had a great answer for how to come at Ben Askren, right? So that's something that I think that maybe his team saw, maybe they're planning, maybe they have some sort of strategy in mind that they go, okay, this is a way we can beat him. But overall, I don't think it's a good fight for Masvidal, and I just see the same result. I don't see any other result happening with this one.
Heidi, that's why I have you on the show, because we are former coworkers. We have chemistry. So you're kind of taking me to my next question or transition, the flying knee. That's where Jorge Masvidal became a star, with the flying knee, whatever it was, 10 seconds real quick. But Jorge became a star because the whole BMF talk. And he kind of blew up. And I got really excited when he became, you know, when he got to the fight against Usman and Fight Island, whatever that was again, short notice, because he was a superstar at the time. He just beat Nate Diaz. He just blew up. But now, Adam, I ask you, he started tweeting a lot. He starts having Goya beans. And there's a lot of things that kind of turned me off about Jorge Masvidal and the former president. I'll just leave it at that with Jorge. But for me, I jumped off the bandwagon. I'm not really a fan anymore of Jorge. I think he's a good fighter. But with the whole tweet, it kind of threw me off. So I ask you, Adam, is he still a major draw for the UFC? Is he still very popular after the whole kind of tweet he's kind of had in the last couple of years? Where's Jorge, especially after such a big loss, too, after Usman? He kind of, you know, went into the, you know, he went back, but then he started tweeting a little more. What do you think? Where is he with the popularity, you think?
Yeah, I mean, he's still there. That's why he's getting the fight. You know, as Heidi mentioned, there's been a problem kind of booking some guys. And, you know, there's some guys that aren't really big draws in that division. And then you've got, like, Colby Covington will fight once every, you know, 2 years. He says he's healthy, I guess. So it's tough to book that fight as well. That fight was a pretty epic one with him and Usman. So I'd like to see that again at some point. But Covington has the same issues that Masvidal does in terms of problematic tweets and things like that. Jorge Masvidal, yeah, he went off the deep end. Like, for those that don't pay attention, like, yeah, he got very political with no basis for it. Like, he the things he was tweeting were not actual, like, you know, he didn't have the same beliefs as the former president, but for some reason he supported him, and he went, like, full Q. That's troubling. Like, to me, that's not political anymore. That's dangerous. And, you know, he said some crazy things online and everything else, but you know, you talked about the flying knees. I'll actually quote Ben Askren, who is fighting and has a very bizarre bout himself. But, you know, he was saying, listen, this is a different sport. And it's an obvious statement, but you also have to put it in perspective. He said, this is a different type of sport. He's like, I was watching a baseball player and I was like, this guy has no social media presence, but it doesn't matter, because if he hits, you know, 40 home runs, he's going to get paid whether he tweets and makes a big deal about it or not. Our sport, that's not the case. You could be terrible. You could lose every fight, but as long as you have a good social media presence, you're going to make a lot of money. And that's kind of what's going on. Like, Jorge Masvidal has a following. People want to see him. He didn't perform well in that last fight, and he gets the fight. And here's the other part. Kamaru Usman wants this fight, and he's the champion, and sometimes you're allowed to make that call. He is saying, hey, I crushed this dude, and he's still talking about short notice and traveling around the world and all this other stuff. Let me beat him with a full camp. Let me make a big paycheck with a guy that can't beat me.
Guys, I kind of want to shift over. There's a lot of hype going on right now about Conor McGregor versus Dustin Poirier 3, the trilogy. That fight is going to be in Las Vegas at the T-Mobile Arena. Heidi, what does this mean for Las Vegas to have fans again at events? And how excited should fans be for this fight?
Well, I think just for the first part with the fans back, it's going to be huge. Obviously, for Conor McGregor, this is the fight that the UFC has wanted. It's the one that they know can be a guaranteed sellout. And, you know, there's not just the Conor McGregor name attached to it and the trilogy aspect tied to it, but for this city, it's kind of a sign of the revitalization of it and the fight capital coming back. So this has always been Fight Capital USA. That's part of the reason why I moved here. It was part of, you know, to cover boxing, to cover UFC, to cover one championship. I'll just throw that out there because it's another promotion, Gilbert, like we talked about earlier. But yeah, that's part of what makes this city electric, and to see it come back is going to be interesting for one to see how they plan the event and how it might set the tone for other events that are coming back, but also just because of looking at restrictions and how will they do the spacing. Does the sellout mean that it's going to be 13,000, or does it mean it's going to be 25,000? You know, so that's something that we'll have to look and see what that all shakes out to, I think. But as far as the fight itself, I'm just looking forward to it, because I think if Poirier can really pull this off again in the rubber match, it's going to be just huge for his name, for his brand. And the whole charity aspect thing that went into it was kind of nuts too. But with Connor's end, it'll prove that he's not washed up, because you're starting to see that go around. Like, is the peak of Connor McGregor over, because he hasn't been able to win in the big keynote fights? But he's still going to be a draw. People will follow him to the moon and back. So for Connor, I don't think there's as much on the line as there is with Poirier and where he stands in the UFC and his aspirations for getting a title belt some point.
Adam, Heidi mentioned it. I mean, that people think Conor McGregor's washed up. He hasn't been the same since he went to fight Floyd Mayweather. Do you believe that he's going to be better in this third fight? Do you feel like we're going to get a different... He keeps on tweeting about it. He puts it on Instagram. Do you feel like, Adam, we're going to get a different Conor McGregor?
We might. I mean, he showed in the past, like when he does rededicate himself and he refocuses, like he can... he can really, you know, get back in there and improve and show great improvement between, you know, fight to the next. I just don't know if it's going to be enough. Dustin Poirier is really, really good. And Connor, as you mentioned, hasn't been the same. And after that fight, that Floyd Mayweather fight, I remember, you know, Dana White making comments about, you know, how hard it is to go to the gym when you don't have to. Like, when you've got $75 million in the bank, are you going to wake up and do that second training session at 4:30 in the morning and then, you know, take a quick nap and then train again? Like, I don't think I would. In fact, I'm going to tell you this. I wouldn't. It wouldn't happen. If I had $75 million in the bank, I'm not doing anything.
And we find you at a Starbucks.
Actually, you probably wouldn't, because I wouldn't even get out of bed to go to Starbucks. So, like, that wouldn't even happen. So yeah, it does become tougher to train when you don't need to and we don't have to do it. And, you know, when you're set for life and everything else. And I think we've seen that out of Connor. He still is, you know, really good with his striking. His timing is impeccable with that left hand. But it's just, he's just not the same going to the gym day in and day out. And I did want to point out on that fight, that is the weekend, you know, if you want to talk about the Vegas being back, and I don't know that we're ready for it. I'm still kind of hesitant on, you know, everybody getting out and getting about all the time. But that weekend will be Conor McGregor, Dustin Poirier at T-Mobile Arena, right across the street at Allegiant Stadium, like less than a half mile away. Garth Brooks has a sold out show. Now, that's not my thing, but I know people are excited about it here. That is insane that those two events are going to be going on at the exact same time.
Fireworks in Las Vegas again. So, Heidi and Adam, which match are you guys looking forward to this Saturday besides the main event? Heidi, I'll start with you.
Oh, man. Hold on. I apologize, but I have it in mind, and I know it's kind of down here on the bottom, so I had to go back and look. Oh, you know what? I'm just scrolling. I'm sorry. Oh, man. There's so many. Okay, I have to pick one. All right. All right. I'll just go, and it's the obvious one. And Adam's probably going to be like, that was what I was going to say. But it's Wiley Zhang and Rose Namajunas, because it's the co-main. And there's been some interesting things happening with Rose this week. Like, I don't know really where all of it's coming from. So I want to see what happens when they actually fight and the words are put to the test against Wiley. Because when people come at Wiley with some crazy talk, she's kind of backed up, you know, everything. She doesn't even need to talk. She just, like, with Joanna, said one simple word, and it was shut up. And the whole fight was crazy. So Rose has been saying, like, that she's got this thing against, you know, China and all of its policies and the things that it's standing for and how it affected her family. And I just, you know, I don't know what all of that's about. I'd love some more context. She said she watched a documentary, and that if we all watched the documentary, that we would be able to understand where she's coming from. I'd love to know what documentary it was so I could go watch it and see where her animosity for China is coming from. But yeah, that's something that's been an underlying story theme throughout this lead up. And I want to see how it pans out in the cage, because Whaley doesn't like when people talk about her. And I think she knows more than she lets on with English and looking and researching everything. So yeah, I think that's going to be a fun one for sure.
Of course, Heidi's right that would be my fight too. I think it's going to be incredible. I mean, anytime Rose fights, it's awesome. But yeah, to add a little more to that, I mean, we talked about Jorge Masvidal getting political. You know, Rose has been saying she used the phrase, which I thought was like dead in the 50s, but she busted out the better dead than red in regards to the Communist Party of China with Wiley Zhang, which is fascinating that she is pinning, you know, the entire nation and its policies to Wiley, saying that she's a tool of the government, that she was put out there by the government as propaganda. And basically, like, she's fighting communism with this fight, which is insane. First of all, it's insane to put that on your shoulders when you're trying to win a title fight, but it does add a lot of drama to this. And I don't know that a lot of people have been paying attention to that aspect of this fight, but it is going to be, you know, globally massive when they step in the cage, just because of those undertones, for sure. But also, you know, Heidi knows this about me, that I've been obsessed with Jessica Andrade since she decided to drop from bantamweight a couple of years ago. And I've just been obsessed with the fact that she is so strong and so just an immovable force in the cage. Now she's up against Shevchenko, who has just been a phenomenal champion, who's really not even had many close calls in her fights, except for, you know, with everybody except Nunez. So I'm excited about that fight as well. I think the two women's title fights are going to be unbelievable. I think the main event in terms of, you know, Usman will probably just run over Masvidal, but the women's fight should be really, really good.
Adam and Heidi, the whole China versus USA thing makes me laugh. You only see that in combat sports, boxing and MMA. they love these
kind of... Rocky versus Ivan Drago.
It's like borderline races, but people kind of like it. But it's just weird trash talk, and it's weird that only in combat sports you could get away with stuff like that. I've never heard of that. You know, whatever, you know, Rose was trying to go, she was kind of reaching there a little too far to sell the fight. Do what you got to do, whatever. But like Adam said, it's going to sell in China because of that whole aspect. But that's weird. But anyways, you know, I like to make money, Adam and Heidi. You know, as you guys know, you know, I'm making this podcast to get rich. So hopefully you guys are going to make me rich. But every time there's a big UFC card, I go to the Las Vegas Review Journal, go to the UFC MMA section, and go for the best bets of Adam Hill and Heidi Fang. And I got to say, you guys are making me some money. So when I go to your best bets, you know, I'm always looking to get rich. But I ask you the question now on my podcast, Compas on the Beat. Thank you for jumping on. You know, shout out to myself on my new show. But Adam and Heidi.
You guys hear that? Me, I.
Oh, yeah, it's all about me. Sorry. But yeah, I guess maybe having this show got him a little, you know, big-headed. But whatever, I'm different. I'm in LA now. You guys are in Las Vegas. But Adam and Heidi, what am I betting on Saturday for UFC 261? It could be maybe an underdog that people are sleeping on, or an over-under kind of total fight. What do you guys got for me?
Adam, who's the dog in the Oliveira Brown fight? Because I think that one could be. That one could be somebody that could pull up some numbers there.
Randy Brown is actually minus 150. So you got a plus 135 on Oliveira.
Yeah, take that, Gilbert. Take Oliveira.
All right, put all my money on there, especially if I don't get these Bad Bunny tickets and I have a lot of money to spend. I'm going to throw it on that guy.
Wait, is the Bad Bunny coming to T-Mobile like next April?
I thought it was March 5th. I already know. It's MGM Grand. Okay. Sorry. I pretend like I don't know Adam, but I know. I already saw the schedule. It's
all right. There you go. I saw the other day. It was like a year away. So whatever that was.
You should have seen how hyped he got for Bad Bunny being at WrestleMania and the way he performed it. And he honestly, Bad Bunny did better than a lot of celebrities have ever done, but he was so hyped for that. Gilbert, tell him what you have coming in the mail.
Oh, I got a Bad Bunny wrestling T-shirt. So
I got
a little crazy. So
I gotta go.
we're gonna end the segment anyway. So thank you, Adam.
On that note, Heidi, Adam, we totally appreciate you guys coming on Compas on the Beat. Honestly, you guys are welcome here anytime. I know Gilbert and his show are excited to have you guys. I mean, that's what I've been hearing. So thank you guys so much. Let fans know where they can find you guys on social media. Heidi, where can fans find you?
I'm on the gram and on Twitter at
Heidi Fang. Wait, can I, instead of shouting out my own, Heidi is now on TikTok. So I'll say to follow Heidi on TikTok.
Yeah, I don't even know how to make a TikTok. I'm going to get a tutoring lesson from one of the young cool kids later.
She doesn't know what she's doing, but she is on TikTok. So follow her. And I'm on all the socials at LLVRJ.
Appreciate you guys so much. Thank you guys. And everybody, Don't go anywhere. We have a little bit more. Stay tuned. What's up, people? It's Fernando Ramirez here. Wanted to take a quick minute to thank you for all the support on this podcast. If you're a fan of Compas on the Beat, please subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Stitcher. Also, please leave us a review and rate us. And of course, we're also on YouTube. We just created a Compas on the Beat YouTube account. That's where you can see me annoy Gilbert after I greet him. What's up, bro? So please subscribe there too. And while you're at it, tell a friend about your compas. Let's grow this pod together. Now, let's get back to the show. All right, guys, welcome back. That was great. Gilbert, I mean, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, definitely. That was another jam-packed show with a lot of good guests, a lot of insight. You know, I had fun talking to former colleagues, Adam and Heidi. You did too with MJ. So we're kind of bringing the whole network together.
Oh, yeah. No, and that's what Compas is all about. We had Ryan on also. That's what it's all about. It's about coming together, having fun. But we still got a little bit left. Don't go anywhere. Gilbert, tell us a little bit about, I mean, we're a couple of weeks in now of the baseball season. How's your fantasy team going?
I'm so glad you asked, Fernando, because my coach, Coach Compa, shout out to Victor Corona, who I got to admit, I kind of threw him under the bus for one of the past episodes we had. And I said, I was a general manager who does nothing and he's the one that calls the shots, my manager. And I kind of questioned him, why did you take Ronald Acuña Jr. from the Braves over Fernando Tatis Jr., your boy, Fernando Tatis? And so far, 2 or 3 weeks later, we're in first place. Coach Compa has my team in first place. I haven't done a lick of work, but I checked the standings and Fernando, my guy, Victor is taking care of my team. Again, I say a lot of our team, but we are in first place. There we go. We are in first place, Victor and I, and shout out to him for selecting Acuña first overall. I'm sorry about your guy, Tatis. Hopefully he comes back healthy, but not for this Dodgers series this past weekend, which... We're going to release this later on. So, you know what I mean?
Yeah, of course. So Gilbert, I did something crazy last weekend. I mean, I've been wanting something and I noticed that during the season, it picked up a lot of steam because of somebody else.
Uh-oh.
Justin Herbert, Chargers quarterback, for all you Charger fans out there. I loved what he did with the victory brisket. How it took on a mind of its own. I remember we shared it on social media and it went crazy and we started asking him, man, I wrote a whole article about victory brisket. So, I mean, it was a lot of fun. So last weekend I was with my mom and we went to Home Depot and I look at it and I'm like, you know what? I want a Traeger grill or a smoker. She's like, really? I'm like, yeah. I want to learn. I mean, Gilbert, you've come over to mi casa es tu casa. I've done grill. I've grilled up steaks and stuff. I've done hamburgers. I think I've mastered the grill. I'm like, I want a new challenge. So she's like, okay. And so we got the smoker and everything. Obviously it didn't fit in the first car we had. So we brought another one. It didn't fit in the second car. So I had to rent one of those small little like trucks that they have. And shout out to the Home Depot there on H Street. They people that were working there, awesome. It was packed. They were still helping us out. They give it to me for free. They let me drive it to my house. It's only right around the corner, but still, I brought it here. I got it. This last weekend, Gilbert, I smoked my first brisket. Very good, honestly. I got to admit, shout out to Justin Herbert, though, for getting me to giving me the motivation to want to be better and getting myself a Traeger grill. I'm honestly so hyped about it, Gilbert. You're going to have to come down. My mom knows already, Gilbert. She's like, hey, Gilbert's coming, Modelos. Like, she already knows that the Modelos have to be there for you. So you got to come down one day. The Traeger grill, honestly, I love it.
Fernando, you are stepping your game up. I feel like I'm left behind. I was just starting with my carne asada, and you're smoking brisket. And I when I first tweeted about Justin Herbert's victory brisket, I said grilled, and people kind of gave me flack for that. It's smoke, right? It's smoke.
Smoker.
So I gotta learn that. But me, I just do the carne asada and hamburguesas and hot dogs. So, but you gotta teach me your ways, and I'm glad you finally went forward for this.
Yeah, no, it was honestly awesome. I'm not a very patient person, Gilbert. I'm very, high energy, all this stuff. I get excited and I'm like, okay, come on. And I could smell the brisket and I had to wait. And it was one of those things, but hey, I'm excited about this. It's going to be a lot of fun. And hey, hopefully we can have Justin on later on, and we can swap some yeah, exactly. We can swap some recipes. There you go. That's what this is all about. That's what Compas is all about. But honestly, guys, we're so excited. Shout out to Ryan, MJ, to Adam, and to Heidi for coming on. We're so excited about the direction that Compas is heading in. Gilbert, any last thoughts?
No, yeah, vámonos. Yeah, apúrate.
Vámonos.
Vámonos.
And that's all, folks.